I think we're seeing something that we frankly did not expect. There's a camera in that courtroom. Was that supposed to be, or would they just be simply ushered out when we're gaveled to order?
There were initially cameras allowed during former President Donald Trump's first day at trial. This is the civil trial he's facing over allegations of financial fraud. Now, just as a quick refresher, just last week, the judge overseeing this trial ruled in a summary judgment that Trump and his co-defendants, which include his sons, did engage in financial fraud. We'll give you the details on that in just a moment. But New York State Attorney General Letitia James is in fact suing Trump for financial fraud. And about an hour before the moment that you're about to watch on tape, Trump's team put out an opposition research file on prosecutor Letitia James, which is part of the reason why I'm assuming she had the look on her face that you're about to see. Let's watch the video.
Quite frankly, I'm not too sure that both parties would want this. I think that Trump views this, the optics of this, as working to his advantage. Look, people looking at this live picture right now will be either filled with rage or they will be thrilled. And that's the problem, is that, you know, you have James now being shown in the background, you've got Trump in the foreground, and it fulfills the narrative on both sides. Trump is likely right. I mean, he's being shown in a sort of tag team series of prosecutions and civil lawsuits where one prosecutor tags another. They're all insisting on these trials occurring before the election.
Now, the voice that you heard in that tape was Jonathan Turley, who was speaking to Fox News at the time. Before I get to more details about what transpired in the courtroom today, Cenk, do you have any thoughts on the commentary you heard?
So I think that that Donald Trump not asking for a jury trial is going to turn into an epic disaster. In terms of Letitia James looking at him in an angry way, I mean, how would you look at him if he called you all those names, right? So, and I don't think that anybody who supports Donald Trump gets to complain about anyone else looking mean or angry or unhinged or anything along those lines. And so there's a lot more to this case, but Donald Trump is in real trouble. And almost every legal analyst, including all the conservative legal analysts, including Jonathan Turley, who you heard on that tape, agree this case is open and shut. And Donald Trump is going to lose an enormous amount of money. I'm not sure he has that much money to lose.
Right, and the prosecutors are looking for $250 million as part of the punishment for the financial fraud. So look, we're gonna get to the oppo file that the Trump team released on Letitia James in just a moment. But before we do, I wanted to fill you in on more details about the unique nature of this trial. We'll get to the decision by the defense attorneys to move forward with this trial without a jury, which I agree seems to be a big mistake. Now, the judge that you also saw in the video is Judge Arthur Engoron, who is overseeing or presiding over the trial. He already ruled in that summary judgment last week that Trump, his adult sons, his businesses, and executives are liable for persistent and repeated financial fraud. Now, the civil trial is basically meant to resolve the other claims that prosecutor James has brought forward, which include falsifying business records, conspiracy to falsify business records, issuing false financial statements, conspiracy to falsify false financial statements, insurance fraud, and conspiracy to commit insurance fraud. And so just to fill you in a little more, the allegation was that Donald Trump essentially inflated the value of his assets in order to secure favorable terms on loans or to obtain the loans in the first place, and also to obtain insurance. Now, those claims require the Attorney General to demonstrate that the false valuations mattered and that Trump acted with fraudulent intent. And that's according to what the judge Engoron said. Trump's attorneys claim that what Trump engaged in was basically a victimless crime, which is real easy to say because, you know, it's harder to show a direct you know, a causal relationship. But the fact of the matter is, when this type of fraud takes place, everyone else ends up paying a price for it in the form of higher fees, more expensive fees. So to say that it's a victimless crime is ridiculous if you ask me. Again, the lawsuit is seeking $250 million, the removal of the Trump family from the Trump organization's leadership, and sanctions that would essentially prevent Trump, his children, and his company from operating a business in the state of New York. Now, the judge and Gorin has already stripped the business certifications from Trump, the Trump organization, and the other defendants in his last ruling. That included the summary judgment. But according to CNBC, it's still unclear if that means the Trump organization is now permanently unable to do business in New York, or if it will be basically legally reconstituted at some later date. Now, Trump has claimed that a disclaimer on his financial statements absolved him of any wrongdoing. He's also arguing that the value of his assets were not, in fact, exaggerated. He posted the following on Truth Social just last night. And Gorin values Mar-a-Lago in Palm Beach, Florida at $18 million when it is worth 50 to 100 times that amount. In other words, Trump is claiming that Mar-a-Lago is worth $900 million to $1.8 billion, which seems like a lot, but I have to be honest with you, I'm not too familiar with that property, how expansive it is. And I mean, it looks like it could be as much as $1 billion. I don't know. I'm not an expert on valuations in regard to real estate and resorts like that. But any comments so far, Cenk?
First of all, on Mar-a-Lago, I briefly worked in real estate. I'm not an expert in Palm Beach properties either. But there's a 0% chance that that is worth $900 million to $1.8 billion. It's the usual ridiculous hyperbole and exaggeration that Trump does, which is deeply ironic because he's in trouble in this case for fraudulently hyping up the value of his real estate. That thing, if it's 10 times more than 18 million, which it probably isn't, it's probably what the judge said it is. But if it was 10 times more, it'd be $180 million, and that would be very impressive. There is no way in the world it is 50 to 100 times that. No way. And only a jackass would say that when you're on trial for overly hyping your value of your properties, right? But speaking of only a jackass would, so Trump is attacking the judge when it's not a jury trial. That means the judge is going to decide. He's going to be the only person who decides. So in the other cases where he's attacking the judges, it's also dumb in other ways. But at least you could make an argument to the jury, and especially if there's a MAGA person on the jury, the judge is being unfair to me, right? But you can't make an argument to the judge that he's being unfair to you because it's him. I don't know if he realizes that. Now, another really important point that other legal experts have made is that this is the type of case that is very unlikely to win on appeal because so much of it is factually based and a jury didn't decide it, a judge decided it. So they are very unlikely to say, no, we believe the lower court judge was wrong on the facts. They usually leave the facts alone, whether a jury or a judge decided it, but especially if a judge decided it. They usually appeal based on law, not facts. So he's in a world of trouble. He has greatly alienated the judge in this case, which no other defendant in their right mind would do. And by the way, there's a great question as to why he didn't ask for a jury trial. Remember, all he needs is one MAGA guy. And although this is a civil case, so it's a little bit different, he'd still have to win overall. But overall, I think he's a lot better off with a jury than he is with a judge. A judge just makes rational decisions, generally speaking, and is not swayed by his emotional appeals, his political appeals, etc. It's possible that his idiotic lawyers, listening to their idiotic client, either chose not to have a jury trial, which is just terrible, terrible legal strategy, or forgot to check the box. And yes, it's a little box on the form, and it's not impossible that these, you know, these blundering idiots forgot to check off the box. So $250 million is probably more than Donald Trump has. And I don't know how this plays out in terms of, okay, he can't have a property, he can't have businesses in New York anymore, and he has to, now the judge has already said that a receivership is beginning for his properties in New York, which he can no longer control. What do they do with those properties? Do they transfer to a different company in a different state? What do they do with his properties that are outside of New York? That's where it gets complicated. But right now, he's on a freight train to bankruptcy. That's my sense of it. And by the way, if Mar-a-Lago is really worth $1.8 billion, then he shouldn't be sweating this. He could easily get a loan for Mar-a-Lago and pay this off, no sweat at all. So Donald, I'm sure you're going to be okay, right? I mean, I'm taking your word for it on Mar-a-Lago, then you shouldn't be bothered by this at all.
It's possible that his defense team made a calculation that having a jury trial in New York, which is obviously a blue state, would not bode well for Trump. So that's a possibility as well. The incompetence, of course, is another possibility. It's not like we haven't seen incompetence from Trump's attorneys in the past. But I do want to move on to the opposition file that the Trump team put out against Attorney General Letitia James. Apparently, he attacked her for a bunch of things that are irrelevant to the trial itself, including the crime rate in New York and the fact that she had previously supported drag queen story hour. But the most substantive of Trump's attacks, and honestly that isn't a high bar, was his claim that James is biased against him. And this is what the oppo file included. Letitia James made clear that getting Trump was the motivating force behind her campaign for attorney general, asserted the Trump campaign, citing James's 2018 promise to shine a bright light into every dark corner of his real estate dealings, and warning that she had her eyes on Trump Tower. Trump submitted that James's comments demonstrated a prejudgment of the facts and a political predisposition to the issues she now must manage apolitically. That was a mistake and a typo, and dispassionately. Now, let me just note that I think that this is the reason why you have a significant portion of Republican voters feeling as though Donald Trump actually did nothing wrong, and all of these prosecutions, whether it be the civil case that we're talking about now or some of the criminal cases that he has been indicted in, it's nothing more than a witch hunt. It's politically motivated. This is how you get the Republican base to essentially reject the idea that Trump ever engaged in any criminality. This is the kind of messaging they're getting day in and day out. And I'm not sure if there would be a way to pursue Donald Trump and his alleged criminality without it appearing political. But the one point that Trump makes in regard to this particular case that I think is legitimate is that it took Letitia James this long to file the civil lawsuit. And it does appear, you know, whether you want to accept it or not, it does appear that the timing is political. But I do believe that the charges have merit. Obviously, the judge overseeing this case believes that the charges had merit, which is why he issued that summary judgment just last week. And any other ordinary American who engages in this level of financial fraud would certainly be prosecuted for doing so. So we'll see how this all ends up. But I also have to just say that video that we opened with Letitia James giving him the dirty eye and all of that, then you go to the judge and he looks jovial and excited. It really isn't a good look. So I don't think the camera should have been in the courtroom to begin with.
Yeah, well, look, the camera wasn't supposed to be there. That's why they were escorted out. And I don't know how a judge is supposed to look. I know that Donald Trump looks like a maniac 24/7. So if you know Anna gets to say it, I get to say it about Letitia James or the judge or whatever. But if you're a Trump fan, you don't get to say how anybody else looks, okay? So you can't say, oh, I'm with the lunatic, but I didn't like the way that Letitia James looked. So by the way, Donald Trump could have had a couple of interesting defenses here. One is the victimless crime that Anna talked about. I don't think it's convincing. I agree with her, but at least it would have been an interesting defense. He could have gone with, there's a disclaimer in there, he's now belatedly trying to do that. But they mainly argued that the properties really were worth that much, which was impossible to prove. There's no way he was gonna win on that. He has different numbers on the tax forms. It's just an open and shut case. I mean, this was butchered in every way imaginable, and he's almost already lost everything. Remember, a lot of the judgments already came in. And I wanna be clear about what's left. So the judge has already ruled, yes, there's, based on the numbers, unquestionable fraud. But now they have to rule on, for some of the charges, intent. And intent's important. And you know, if he's trying to prove that he had no intent in inflating his numbers, again, that inflating the Mar-a-Lago number in the middle of this trial is not going to help his cause that he's not doing it with intent. And by the way, in that same angry rant on Truth Social against the judge and against all of these different things, he said, "And how come I'm not allowed a jury trial?" Because you didn't ask for one, jackass.
Hey, thanks for watching the video. We really appreciate it, guys. And we appreciate it if you become members, because that allows us to be independent, honest, progressive, all the things that you don't get from corporate media. And all of that is because of you guys. Hit the join button below and become one of us, become a Young Turk.